knowledge of HTML language is very important. Okay, many people, they just try to ignore it. Okay, you just cannot ignore it. Okay, just cannot ignore it. It's very important. So what I'll do is I'll make an Excel file over here. So that will be very helpful to you later on. Called as html.xls. Okay, now in this I'm going to create three columns. Element, tag, and attributes. Soon you will come to know what these columns do. Okay, just hold on. Now, what all kind of elements we have with us? Okay, we generally we deal with normal, say a link on a page. Then there is an input field. Then there is sometimes a drop down, right? There are radio buttons. There are check boxes. There are normal buttons as well, right? Then there are images on the page. There is text present on the page, fine. And at times, okay, these are some of the major ones. Okay, these are some of the major ones, major HTML components which you deal with. Okay, now every HTML component has a tag name and an attribute associated with it. Okay, to understand what a tag is and to understand what an attribute is, alright, you will have to install something known as Firebug in your system. Firebug as well as Firepath. Okay, these two are add-ons under Mozilla. Okay, open your Mozilla browser, go to Google and just type download Firebug. Okay, it's an add-on in Mozilla Firefox. You click on this and you can click on this add to Firefox image. Make sure you open this link inside the Firefox, or Firefox will be restarted. And after restarting, you will get an image out here in Firefox. You will get an image of a bug. This is Firebug. When you open it, you will get a screen like this. Okay, having these windows, console, HTML, CSS, script, DOM, .NET, and Firepath. This will not be present. Okay, I'll talk about this Firepath in some time. Okay, but if you select the HTML tab and you click on this mouse over here, the small arrow. Okay, I'm talking about this arrow out here. If you click on this, then wherever you move your mouse on the page, you will start getting the HTML page behind the source code of that element. Suppose I click on this and I then take my mouse over this search box and I click on the search box. So what Firebug will give you, it will give you the highlighted code of this search box. Okay, this is very important in Selenium. This has got nothing to do with Selenium. Okay, Firebug is not by people who made Selenium, but it helps us to investigate the page source. Similarly, in Chrome as well. Okay, in Chrome, if I am on any page, if I right click on any element, I get an option inspect element. If you inspect it, then you will get a window like this. Okay, in IE, you have got IE developer kit. You can refer that. You have got IE developer tools are there. Fine, you can go into IE developer tools and you can do it. You can investigate the page source. In Chrome, you just right click on any element, you will get inspect element link. Okay, now how is this helpful? This is helpful because Selenium actually works inside the page source. Okay, now suppose I am on the landing page of Gmail. Okay, and I use Firebug on it. I try to inspect this username field. This is the code corresponding to the username field. Okay, the conical bracket and this, the highlighted portion, this is the tag name. The tag name for an for a text field is always input. All the text fields in the world, in all the web-based applications, will have the tag name as input. Okay, remember that. So out here, the, for an input field, the tag name is input. For a link, okay, if I investigate a link, for example, a link like learn more, if I investigate, then it's got a tag name like A. All the links in every web applications have this anchor tag. All the links will have, see that about Gmail also has this A. So for a link, the tag name is A. For a drop list, okay, suppose I go to this website quicker.com. It's a classified website in India. If I look at this drop list, this is the drop list. It's got the tag name as select. Okay, it's got the tag name as select. So the drop down has tag name select. For a radio button, okay, if you go to Google, I'm telling you this because it is very important. You should know what the elements in the page look like. In QTP, if somebody has worked on QTP, you have got objects file. It pulls out the all the objects, all the object properties, and it gives you in a very, it gives you the properties in a very systematic way. If anybody has worked on QTP, but in Selenium, we don't have that systematic way. It's an open source tool. Okay, so we have to learn a little bit about HTML, right? If I write radio buttons in HTML and say I go here, on this page I have got these three radio buttons. Fine. Now the specialty of radio buttons is that in one radio group, only one radio button can be selected. Okay, and if I use Firebug on a radio button, then the tag name again for radio button is input. Okay, for a radio button, the tag name is input. And from my experience, I'll tell you, the checkbox also has the input tag name. The button also has the tag name called input. Okay, if you go to this Gmail page, back to Gmail page, right, if I look at the sign in button, then the tag name is input. Okay, and for image, for an image, if you look at Gmail, this is an image, Gmail, Google is the image out here. For all the images in the web based applications, the tag name is img. For text, there is no particular tag name. Sometimes it is under the para tag p, sometimes it's under division, sometimes it's under span. Okay, you cannot just have one particular tag name for a general text on the web page. Okay, now these are the elements on the page, these are the tag names, and what are attributes? First question, what are attributes? Secondly, the input field also has the tag name input, radio button has the tag name input, checkbox again has input, and button again has got input. So how do we differentiate between them? We differentiate with the help of attributes. Every tag has a set of mandatory and you can say optional attributes. Okay. I'll talk about mandatory attributes. Some attributes are mandatory, some are optional. For example, let's talk about the input field first. Okay, if I go to Gmail and I look at this input field, then this is the tag name, right? This tag has got these all attributes. That is, the ID is email, type is text, value is blank, that means nothing is written in this input field, name is email. So ID, type, value, name, spell check, all these are attributes. Okay, out of this, the type attribute is mandatory. Every text field in the world, every text field in every web-based application will have this attribute. Input type equals to text, it represents that this is a text field. Okay, so the mandatory attribute for an input field is type equals to text. Okay, all other are optional, it's up to the developers. If the developer he decides, fine, I don't want to give an ID, he can skip the ID. If I don't want to give a value, I can skip a value. If I don't want to give a name, I can skip a name. But he cannot afford to skip the type attribute. He has to write it. Okay? In Gmail, we have the sign in button. And we saw that the buttons, they also have the input tag name. But for a button, this is the button, this is the code for the button. Input is the tag name, ID is an attribute, class is an attribute, type is submit, value is sign in. Value attribute means what is written on the button. See, sign in is written on the button, right? The value attribute, it defines what is written on the button and name. Who has given these attributes? The developer has given these attributes, right? Out of all these attributes, this type attribute, again, it is mandatory in case of buttons. Type equals to submit. It means that it is a button. If it is an input tag and type is submit, that means it's a button. Okay. For a drop list, the tag name is select. Okay. There are no mandatory attributes for a drop list. Okay. For a link, the tag name is A, right? There is a attribute called, for every link, you will have the attribute href. Href will tell you the URL to which the link is pointing to. I hope everybody knows this, right? So the href attribute out here, it tells you the URL to which the link points to. In case of a drop down, there are no mandatory attributes. In case of a radio button, okay, I'll just go back. This was the radio button, right? Okay, if you look at the radio button, then these are the attributes. The type attribute, it tells you the type of the object, that is, it is an input field. So type equals to radio, it defines that it's a radio button. And type equals to checkbox, I'll not waste time, checkbox, it defines that it's a checkbox. Okay, in case of an image, right, always remember that in case of an image, for example, there is an image out here. This is an image, echoecho.com. This is an image. It's got the tag name as img. There is always an attribute called src, which points towards the URL on which this image is pointing to. This is the URL. Suppose if I copy this URL and I go to this URL, here is the image. Okay? So the src attribute, it points towards the location at which this image is lying on the server. Okay, so these are the mandatory attributes. In text has not got any mandatory attribute. Okay, link, radio, checkbox, buttons and all. another element is there which is not visible to our eye, that is known as a frame or an iframe. I will talk about them later on. Okay, there is a special way to handle them. Again, and another element is there which is not visible to the normal eye, that is a web table. Many of you might have heard about it. I will talk about these elements later on. But the elements which are visible to the normal human eye, these are the elements, and these are the tag names for them, and these are the mandatory attributes. Okay, so now how do we use them in Selenium? Okay, how do we use them in Selenium? In Selenium, especially in WebDriver, okay, there are various identification ways. Okay, you can identify, I'll make another column, Selenium identification. Okay, now in my project out here, I successfully navigated to gmail.com with the help of Firefox Drive. Now suppose I have to enter the username, enter the password and continue forward. Fine. Now the thing is that I'll have to identify that element first. Okay, so there is a particular way to identify. In Selenium you can identify an element on the basis of its ID. Okay, we all saw that when we were on Gmail, the developer had given an attribute called ID to every element. Okay, generally if he is a good developer, he will always give a unique ID to every element on your page. A unique ID I am talking about. Sometimes the developers, they make a mistake that they give the same ID to multiple objects. Okay, then you have to identify it in a different way. Okay, I am taking the scenario that a unique ID is there with every element. There is an attribute called name, a unique name associated with every element as well. Okay, so you can identify an element with the help of name as well, provided the developer has given an ID or a name to it. Okay, or if it's a link, you can also identify a link with the help of link text or partial link text. I'll tell you how do we do that in Selenium. Okay, just hold on. I'm just noting down some of the commonly used ways. There is something known as XPaths as well. This is quite interesting. Okay, XPath is like, you can say, it's like an address of an element. Okay, you live somewhere, you have a house number, you have a street address, you have a flat address, apartment address, right? Okay, that address uniquely identifies your house. Anybody can reside in that house. Okay, but the address will remain same. For example, I go to this website bbc.com. Now on this web page, you have got elements. We have got links, we have got a lot of things. Okay. Now the basic thing is that the layout of this website remains same. But every 24 hours, the complete website changes. The complete news, it changes, but the layout remains the same. Okay, every element on this page, for example, this highlighted link over here. Okay, this will represent the headlines, right? Now every 24 hours the headlines will change. Okay, if I look at this headlines in my Firebug, then this is the headline. Okay, now the headlines they change, but there is something known as XPath. It will remain the same. It will not change until the position of this headlines the change. Okay. So you can also identify an element with the base of XPath. Now, what do you mean by XPath? Okay, I'll just tell you practically. Suppose if I go to my website, let's go to a very simple page. Okay, this is the page to enter your username and password in my website. Okay, and if I look at the element out here, email, element, email, if I look at it out here in your page source, then this is the one, input type equals to text, name equals to email. Obviously it's an input type, the type is text. Now what will be the XPath? You know the XPath will start from the base of the HTML document. There are two types of XPaths. One is partial and one is complete or absolute. Or absolute XPath. Partial or I can write absolute XPaths. Fine. So I'm talking about absolute XPaths right now. So if you go out here, open a notepad, then the location of this element, that is this particular element which is input type text, type equals to text equals to email. How does this start? Everything is inside the HTML tag. Okay, so the first, I'm making an XPath out here, please be vigilant, it's important. The first tag name is HTML. Fine. Inside HTML tags, there is a head tag and body tag. Always remember, all the piece of information on your page is inside the body tag. Okay. So inside HTML, there is a body tag. Then under the body tag, you have the div tag. This is the div. So I'm trying to reach the element. Okay. There is also a table tag, but the element is not present in that table. Okay, so there is a div tag, div class equals to make border. So there is a div tag. Under the div tag, there is a form. Okay, form tag. So there is a form tag. I'm trying to reach that particular element. Under the form, there is a table tag. Okay, so there is a table. Then table body, t body, this one. Then a tr tag, this one. Okay, but be very careful, under the table body tag there are 5 tr tags. I am interested to go under the first tr tag. Okay, so I will write like this, tr1, like this, table row 1, I'll just make it a little bit smaller, right, that is table row 1, okay, so the control will go inside it. Now under this table row, there are 4 td tags, I am interested to go inside the third td tag, because inside the third td tag, my input tag is present. Okay, so there is the third td tag and under this I have the input tag. So this is the XPath. This will always remain same. Okay, if it had been text, okay, maybe the text changes, but this tag, the hierarchy of the tag will remain same until or unless the developer, he never adds up something on the page. Right, look, the fundamentals are very important. I'm going by the fundamentals out here. Okay, if I want, I can start directly writing the script. You will be able to understand. But these fundamentals, they come into the picture when you are stuck in Selenium. Okay, when you are not able to find an object. Suppose there's a link, your Selenium code is not clicking on that link. At that point of time, people get stuck because they don't know these fundamentals. Okay. Selenium works on these fundamentals. It works on the page source through the tags and all. Okay. Now this is known as the absolute XPath. Okay. Now it is not good to use this expand. We never use it. Okay. Until or unless I am forced to use it in very, you can say in very rare circumstances. Okay. Rarest of the rare, I use it. Why don't I prefer to use it? Because if by chance the developer he changes anything, okay, he introduces a new tag in between, then my XPath is invalid. I'll have to go and change the code again. Okay, if I'm using this XPath in my Selenium code to identify this element, then I cannot do anything. Okay, so we never permit the usage of absolute XPaths. Okay, until or unless it is very necessary. Okay, now it's not always that you make the absolute XPath like this. You cannot do that in a big application. I made it manually. You never make it manually. There is an add-on called FirePath, which is add-on on the top of Firebug. When you install Firebug, I just explained you how to install Firebug, right? This FirePath will not be there. Okay, so after installing Firebug, please note the point. After you have installed Firebug, go to Google and type download FirePath. Okay, FirePath is an add-on which gets installed on the top of Firebug. FirePath is a Firebug extension. Okay, you add it inside Mozilla. Once you add it, you'll get this FirePath option. Okay, now if I go to gmail.com, I will get, if I move my mouse over this username field, I will get this option. This is my XPath. Okay, you select this, generate absolute XPaths. You select this option. So what will it give? It will give you the XPath for each and every element. You see that wherever I move my mouse, I get the absolute XPath of those elements. Okay, but we never generate these absolute XPaths. Don't use it because Firebug also gives you partial XPaths. Okay, that is if I try to find the XPath of the username, this is the XPath. //*ID equals to email. FirePath will make XPath based on the ID attribute of an element. Okay, so it makes like this, that is *ID equals to email. That means there is an element on the page whose ID is email. You can name the element as input. Instead of *, is a generic regular expression. Instead of that, I can write input. That means there is an input field in my page whose ID is email. Right? Now, what if two elements on the page have the same ID? Will this XPath work? If I have to select the second element, well, it will not work. I'll talk about that scenario later on, right? But right now, just try to understand it like this. What if the element has got no ID? That's also one of the scenarios, right? For example, I go to this page in.rediff.com. Okay, it's again a website in India, right? I try to investigate this sign-in link. So I get this XPath. This is again a partial XPath. It means //*, there's an element on the page whose ID is sign-in info. And inside it, there's an anchor tag A, the first anchor tag. Inside it, there's a link. So what Firebug does is, it gives, this is my link. Okay, this link has got no ID. Right? So it gives, it goes one step above the link. It finds that there's a span with the ID sign-in info. Okay? So it finds the span. There should be a span with the ID sign-in info. And inside it, there's a link. So if there is no ID, it will keep on traversing up, right? So this is absolute XPath. It is evil to use this. You should always use this partial XPath. Even something changes in between, the partial XPaths will not change. Even if the location of the element changes. So tomorrow, suppose the sign-in link, it is removed from here and it is put somewhere out here. Then also this will be detected by Selenium. Okay? But if I had taken the absolute XPath, then Selenium would not have been able to detect it. Okay. So if you want to check the position of an element, sometimes the people they come to me and tell me, how can I check whether the element is at the right position or not? Use the absolute XPath. It actually in the DOM, that means in the document object model. This is known as the DOM of the page. I didn't tell you, I'm sorry. Okay, in the document object model, it actually tells you the location. Right? Okay, now let's go back to WebDriver and see how can I utilize this. Okay, in WebDriver, always remember, if you have studied QTP, okay, in QTP we call everything, categorize everything inside an object, as an object. We call it object, object is not visible, object this, object that, right? In Selenium, whosoever has made WebDriver, he has categorized everything inside an interface called web element. Okay, for Selenium everything is a web element. If I go to gmail.com, this button is a web element, this link is a web element, this input field is a web element, everything is a web element. To identify a web element, you can use ID, name, link text, partial link text, XPath, or something known as CSS selectors as well. I'll talk about that. Right now I'm not concentrating on this. Right? So you can take up anything. If I open up my Eclipse, right, I'll make a new file over here. gmail.java. Right? Inside it I will write WebDriver driver equals to new Firefox driver. Now why am I writing like this? WebDriver is the interface. Firefox driver is the class which is implementing the interface. Remember, bank D1 equals to new HSBC. Bank was the interface, HSBC was the class implementing this interface. Through B1, I could only access those functions which came from the bank interface and which were implemented in the HSBC class. Similarly, out here I'll write web driver, driver equals to new Firefox driver. Why do we have to write like this? That's the first question. Why do we have to write like this? Because sometimes what happens is that we read it like this, browser equals to Firefox. We generally read this browser type, the browser on which we have to do the testing, from an external source like an XM file or a property file, right? So we read it from that. Right now I'm hard coding, and then we keep a condition that if, okay, we keep it like this, web driver driver equals to null. That means this driver object is not pointing towards anything. We keep a condition that if the browser is equal to Firefox, then initialize it with the Firefox driver. Else if the browser is equal to IE, then initialize this with the help of Internet Explorer driver. Okay, else if the browser is equal to Chrome, then initialize it with the help of Chrome driver. Okay, so this helps us to initialize the web driver the way we want it. In the external data source, suppose there is an XML file or an XLS file or a text file, whichever it is. We will specify the type of browser we will want to test on. Okay, we will read that file. I'll talk about that concept later on, reading the file. And depending on the browser type, we'll initialize the driver. This is how it helps us. Okay, so tomorrow if I want to execute the same script on a different browser, I will not have to change the code. I just have to change the external file name. That's how we do it practically. Okay, now after that I will go to Gmail and write whichever driver is there, all the drivers will have the get function in them because all the drivers are implementing the web driver interface. Okay, driver dot get http://gmail.com. Fine. Now after that, I have to enter username. Okay. Now this username field is a web element. It's known as a web element. It falls under the category of web element. Okay. Interface in Selenium documentation. If you look at the Selenium documentation, download Selenium. If you look at the Java docs, then this has got an interface called web element. Okay, this web element interface, right? When I write like this, if I write driver dot find element by the ID, by is a inbuilt class, by dot ID, and you specify the ID of that element over here. For example, I specify the ID of the username field, that is email. It will find the username field and put it in a web element reference. Driver dot find element. Find element is a function under web driver interface. Okay. If you go here and if you see web driver interface, this has got a function called find element, which returns you the object or reference of web element interface. Okay. By what criteria you should be finding an element? This by class, this by is an inbuilt class again in the API, class by, which has got the criteria that you need to find it by class name, CSS selectors or ID or link text, name, partial link text, tag name. What is the tag name? We just studied tag name. These are the various tags in the website. Okay, like link, input, radio, drop down. Okay. Or by the XPath. We also studied the XPath. Okay. So these are the various identification mechanisms. So right now I'm using this function by the ID. Right. Driver dot find element by which criteria? The criteria of ID email. So we get the web element, import web element. Now if you go to the documentation and look at the web element documentation, then these are the functions which can be carried out with every web element. Clear, click, just ignore these two, we'll talk about them later on. Get attribute, get CSS value, get location, get size, tag name, text is displayed, is enabled, write is selected, send keys, submit. So these are the functions. The send keys function inside the web element use this method simulate typing into an element which may set its value. Okay. So if I write username dot send keys some value, so this will send a username inside the input box. Similarly, I will have a web element called password. Okay, this will be out here. The password web element has an ID called passwd. Okay, I will find it by the ID and I will write password dot send keys some password. And similarly, I will find the button, the submit button by the ID of the button will be, this is the ID, sign in, right? The developer is good, he has assigned IDs to every element, right? And I will write submit button dot click. right? So these all are web elements. These send keys, click, clear functions, all these functions, they are present with the web elements. Okay, it will get clear to you as you proceed. This is not something which can be learned overnight. You have to practice. Okay, when I run this code, it opens up Mozilla, goes to the website Gmail, and it enters username, password, and it clicks on this sign in. Right? It was very fast. Now, what if I don't have the ID of the element? Okay, in that case, I can use some other identifying mechanism. That is driver dot find element by the, you get all these features. How? By the name. Has the element got a name? Let's see. Has the username got a name? Yes, it's got a name. The developer has assigned a name attribute. The name is email. See, that's why HTML language is very important. Okay? It is the basic. So you can identify it by on the basis of name. Now also when I run this code, when I run this, it will go to Gmail and again enter the name. You see that? Right? What if I don't have the name as well? ID is not there, name is not there. Then you can use XPath as well, right? You can write driver dot find element by class dot the XPath. The by class, as I explained to you earlier as well, by class in Selenium has got various identification mechanisms. ID, if ID is not there, go to name. If there is a link, it can be identified by the link text as well. Okay. So you can take the XPath as well, right? So you can go here and find the XPath of this username field. In FirePath, you will get the XPath. Right? So, So this is the XPath. Okay, so you can copy this XPath. Don't copy this dot. Okay, copy this XPath and put it out here. Now also it will work. Right? Or you, instead of this star, it's always, star is, you know, generic. Okay, you can make it more specific. This will also work with this star. But you can give a tag name, that is input. Alright, so this is all about today, right? I'll not confuse you much.